Good evening and welcome to Plain Talk. My name is Christopher M. Thank you for joining me on this pre-Diwali evening as we discuss issues of national and indeed international significance. Over the past couple of days, the leaders of the world, minus China and Russia and a few other countries, were in Glasgow, Scotland, where they were addressing their minds to solutions relating to the environment. As we all know, the planet is warming, and unless drastic action is taken, as the Secretary General of the United Nations, I think it was, said, we're a minute before midnight, unless we address the pressing issues of greenhouse gases and the whole question of the environment, then we will be in serious trouble. I think the case was eloquently made by our own Caribbean leader, Barbados Prime Minister Mia Mottley, who spoke for just over 8 minutes to world leaders. And I think by any measure, you had Sir David Attenborough, you had some of the really important people on the environment there. But of all the contributions, I think Mia Mottley was indeed the best. So it's a pretty technical subject. We will be discussing issues relating to global warming, the consequences for countries like Guyana, which is below sea level, and as the ice melts at the various poles, then sea level will rise, and what will happen is that certain countries will absolutely disappear. Certain countries in the Caribbean, and Mia Mottley she mentioned Barbados, she mentioned Antigua, and of course there is Guyana, that will suffer dearly in relation as a consequence of global warming unless we were to keep the rise in temperature somewhere to 1.5% above what it was at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, at the industrialization of the world. My guests this evening are Mr. Jonathan Yearwood, who is on the extreme left, and to his right, Dr. Yog Mahadeo, two persons who I know have been engaging in this discussion on the environment and COP26. As time permits, we will also be dealing with two issues of particular interest to an organization which was recently formed, including these two gentlemen, Article 13, and we'll be touching on the vast number of constitutional requirements that our past and present government have been ignoring without any regard for the implications for our democracy, for our rule of law, and for cohesion in our society. So let me start by throwing the question out. COP26. Was it worth it?
COP26, yes, it's always worth it to have world leaders gathered together and sign documents to reduce carbon emissions, etc., etc. As you said, the 26 indicates that they've had 26 meetings already. This is the 26th meeting. And we know that the world keeps getting hotter regardless of what the world leaders talk about. So the question is, when these world leaders go back to their respective countries, are they honestly and genuinely going to live up to the commitment that they have made to the rest of the world? Our president, Mr. Irfan Ali, committed Guyana to a 70% reduction of carbon emissions by the year 2030, which is 9 years from now. A 70% reduction. How are we going to do this? How does the government plan to do this? Bearing in mind, we are now an oil producer. We are now producing oil. So how are we going to reduce our emissions? So I would like to hear what the government plans are for them to reduce this emissions by 70%. First of all, I would like to find out what is our present level of emissions. And then we can see what the 70% reduction will be like. Because when you use percentages, it's a measurable amount. So it's something that has to be able to be measured. So we must have a starting point. The starting point is today. What are our emissions as of today?
Do you think the EPA is competent to tell us that?
I don't think the EPA is competent enough to even hold an office, because they have little or no technology, they have little or no skills to be able to do anything concerning the environment. And that came out very recently, that they are incompetent. They are giving waivers to companies who are affecting the environment, but they have no technical skills to do that. So how can they really function in that way? How are they really saying that we can give a waiver where they don't have the technical skills to determine what the waiver entails? So I have little or no faith whatsoever in the EPA. The Environmental Protection Agency in Guyana is a colossal failure. And I can give you the example where they recently gave permission for a cement factory on the East Coast without any consultation to the citizens of Guyana, of the villages that would be affected. And it's only by chance two citizens saw an article, a tiny piece in the news or the article, or in the newspaper, and hired lawyers to challenge it. And EPA had to backtrack. So the EPA has little or no capacity to do anything along the environment in Guyana. That's my opinion.
Jörg, do you support Messiah? Yeah. Would rather grim view, yeah, of the EPA?
Well, I would want to say that the reports that have been published on the oil and gas, for example, the gas to energy project, for example, speaks to something else than what the EPA has done. That waiver that was given, to which the vice president spoke so eloquently about, there is a report that has been published and shared by the current government of Guyana that speaks to the EPA not having the ability and the wherewithal to do the evaluation for gas to energy projects. So if you don't have the wherewithal to do that evaluation, how do you then have to give a waiver? But Chris, I just want to quickly point out a couple of things. One is the climate change concerns. You're so right. The Prime Minister of Barbados spoke so well. I think she spoke from the heart, both as a politician and as a person directly affected. She spoke so well, and we got to remember that there's a emissions gap, as you rightly mentioned, a 1.5 degrees Celsius. We are on track for a 2.7 degrees Celsius by the end of the century. My Motley mentioned her country and other countries in the Caribbean are on the Voice at a 1.5. So if we are looking at those numbers, 1.5 versus we are going like a runaway train towards a 2.7, I mean a few countries wouldn't exist and half of Guyana wouldn't. Because, you know, a lot of Guyana is, you know, at the front of the ocean or rivers. Now, the other thing I want to mention, though, that just to clarify, Jonathan, that the government, there are two things that we need to look at. One is the government did they claim that they have done a lot of research heading into Glasgow. They pulled together EPA and a number of agencies and bodies to do their research and headed to Glasgow. But I think civic society is questioning, where is the broad consultation? Where is the broad consultation? What the government, this government and the last one has been good at doing is bring together people that agree with their views or the way they want to do things and, you know, have the reports slanted towards that. And my last thing on this Glasgow, the COP26, Chris, is government should have consulted before. How many Guyanese are aware of this emissions gap or aware of this entire thing? So the president and vice president and everybody seems to be on a on this international tour, representing their political and individual agendas. At the end of the day, they have to be reminded they are accountable to the people of Guyana. What are the details of the Dubai trip? How much did it cost us? We are hearing that Dubai paid so much money or gave so much money. As you know, gifts are something that has to also be fully disclosed. But what are the details? We have seen people write to the newspaper to say they paid their fare to go. What are the details? You are accountable. You are the head public servant. You're accountable to the people again on this Glasgow trip. What are the details? What are the, how much is it costing us to send you there? And stuff like that. But to the technical aspect, I totally agree with you. And I would urge everybody, if you can, get Maya Motley's short but real profound statement and listen to it. And it will really reveal a lot of what's going on and where we need to head towards.
Now, Chris, I'd like to go with something that Jung said just now. York said that when the government was planning with the stages to go to COP26, they used information from the EPA, which I find extremely strange because the vice president just said recently that the EPA is incompetent. So you're using...
Those are his words?
Well, not his exact words, but okay. He hinted that they didn't have the technical expertise, etc. So you are taking information from an agency that you deem incompetent and then taking that information and carrying it to COP26. Well, that I find very hypocritical.
Well, we heard that the president made a commitment and may have even signed on. Though, you know, one was not quite sure on what we have signed on to. But if the government was indeed serious, would it not have had, it would have known COP26 was scheduled since Paris.
Yes.
But because COP26, I think, should have been last year, no?
Yes.
Because
yeah.
Paris was 2015.
Well, Chris, just stick a pin. So, Mr. Jagdeo did say, in fact, he placed the blame totally on the feet of APNU for having committed Guyana to so much percentile.
I'm not working on the details. I'm saying that the government knew they have been in power since August 2nd.
Correct.
2020. They knew close to what? 15 months ago?
Yes.
That this conference was taking place.
Correct.
That they were required to make commitments. You people are from Article 13. Yeah. It requires Article 13 says you must have the participation.
Correct.
Should the government not have had these consultations before they went to Glasgow?
Correct.
Yes. That's my question.
Yes. The short answer is yes. There should be, and on many fronts, not just this matter of environment. On many fronts, there need to be broader consultation with the people of the stakeholders in Guyana. And they knew of this before, and even before they got into power, because they were the only opposition.
Yeah.
So Chris, the short answer is yes. However, I would also like to point out that when we talk about emissions and all of that, you know, so many years ago we would have heard since Chetty Jagan's time about the New World Order, mm-hmm. and then Jagdeo and would have come out with the what's they call it? LDCs. Then you have
LCDS,
the LCDS, sorry, and then you have had now the newer version of it. So they have been working on this from 20 years ago, right? So that's one aspect. And the second one is, unfortunately, Guyana has adopted a pay-to-flare. You can't get away from that.
Yes.
So you're on the world stage representing something, yet to the back in your pocket, you're being paid to allow Exxon to flare. And that is a great danger.
Yeah. So my worry about what you're saying there is the absolute lack of consultation that took place. Because in today's newspapers, the Deputy Speaker, Leonard Schumann, who you can consider to be one of the leaders of the Armenians in Guyana, came out and said that they were not consulted with this decision to lower emissions by 70%. The Armenians who live in the forest, who live primarily along the rivers and in the jungles of Guyana, were not consulted as to how this emissions will be cut. How will it affect their livelihood, their way of living? They were not consulted.
Well, I've got a couple of instances that sound to me, if not paradoxical, certainly contradictory. One of the key issues at COP26 was that you shouldn't only not be subsidizing, but you shouldn't be lending
mm-hmm.
to these fossil fuel
yes.
entities. Guyana is actively subsidizing one of the worst destroyers of the
environment.
On collectively, the oil companies.
Yes.
That to me just does not make sense. How do you reconcile the two?
There's no way you can reconcile that, because if you go back to the oil contracts, Guyana has signed on to paying the taxes, the corporate taxes for the oil companies that are operating here. So that by itself is a subsidy. So if we have signed a contract to do that, and then we're telling, our president is now telling the world that countries shouldn't stop subsidizing oil companies,
mm-hmm.
we should then turn and tell those very same oil companies, you pay your own taxes. Guyana will not pay your taxes for you. But our president hasn't said that. He is still going to go ahead and allow Guyana to pay taxes for Exxon, Hess, and the Chinese company. So it is hypocritical that you're telling the world stage one thing and then doing something in your own backyard, doing the opposite.
Yoga, I'm going to ask you to comment on this.
Mm-hmm.
We read in the newspapers, even as you say that, that the arising from these efforts in the Middle East with UAE and United Arab Emirates, those people are coming to help to get into mining and into forestry.
And agriculture.
Well, no, agriculture one can understand.
Yeah, indeed.
Because agriculture could be favorable, mm-hmm. depending on what kind of agriculture you do.
Correct.
That we have to wait and see.
But the extraction. Surely you cannot be talking of COP26 and inviting other people. You know, we boast about how these people are going to lend us money. They only want, the only targeting our natural resources.
Yes.
The new thing is oil. And the Malaysians love to exploit other people's forests. They want to destroy our forests like how they destroyed the road. Isn't is not again a contradiction?
It is definitely a contradiction, because the other thing to that tags along with that is that as yet we don't seem to have developed any methodology, any metrics that can measure what we are promising the world. Or forget about promising the world, Jonathan, Chris, what are we doing to ourselves? I remember writing to the press a little while back. I mean, you know, what are future generations, what are they going to be talking about our generation? And yet we have politicians saying, well, we should not be saving for future generation at the expense of current generation. You know, fine, if you don't want to save the world,
That is so much a nonsense.
Yeah, it is, but that aside,
you read the Constitution, it says as a fundamental right, only the existing generation, but future generation.
But separate the two. So there's one with the wealth, the physical wealth, but the other one is at spending out what you have available. You're destroying everything. You're destroying the environment. You're destroying everything that has to do with anything here. I mean, at the rate, coming back to COP26, at the rate that global warming is going to go, we're soon going to be hearing all the talks about moving the city, but nobody has a measurement to say, well, if global warming continues at the rate it is, or drops by 1 degree even, what degree of Guyana will be impacted, and what preparation do we have in place for that? Now, I'm sure, Chris, when we raise these things in public forum like we're doing now, the answers will come, well, we got those studies, and you got so much 200,000 sheets of reports available and stuff like that. And this is where we come back to the core. We don't need to be told things on a need-to-know basis. We need to be consulted. Guyanese need to be informed, and we need to be taking part with things step by step as they happen.
Yes.
But it's not what the Constitution calls for.
Exactly.
It's not what you're
organizing. That's what Article 13 is about.
Now, let me give you another example. We have had a lot of money being given and monetary assistance to persons. Mm-hmm. Some of it is for COVID, as some COVID related, but a lot of it has to do with flooding.
Yeah.
Forget the fact that we give to farmers without asking them, well, ask you pay any taxes. Mm-hmm. We do not even ask the most fundamental question, do you have a taxpayer identification number?
Correct. No, I think the most fundamental question is, do you actually farm?
Yeah. you are being cynical, but
no, I'm not.
The point I'm making is this: we are paying out a lot of money for flooding.
Yeah.
Guess what? Flooding is a consequence of that same global warming,
the climate change.
We don't seem to understand, and that's the problem I do have with our policymakers, all of them. And I'm including the opposition in this regard. They don't seem to understand that there are causes and effects.
Yes.
By allowing the Malaysians to come and exploit your forestry, by allowing the Emirates and the Sheikhs to come and get into the mining.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're doing.
Yes.
And then who bears the cost? Who bears the cost of the EPA? Who bears the cost of all these studies? You know, I have to say this publicly, we audit a commercial bank. We audit insurance companies.
Mm-hmm.
Those people have to pay the regulator.
Yes.
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 Both on the banking and insurance.
Yes.
Nobody pays the oil companies, get away scot-free, and you right, Jonathan. We pay them. The more profits they make is the more tax relief we give them.
Yes.
It just does not make sense. Now, when you look at those taxes in the context of this G20, the largest economies of the world, they have just said you must pay 15% of taxes in the country in which you operate.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Does that apply to Exxon and Guyana?
Nope. Correct.
So, you know, one doesn't. We're not. Certainly, I'm not wise. I'm. You've got wise people in the government and the cabinet. they know all these things. But how do they explain this?
Yes.
That we have just over 130 countries now, incredibly. I've been trying to get from the government, are we one of those 130 countries? You know, we can't get an answer. I will be penning a letter to the Commission of Information to ask, because I've tried all the connections I have. Mm-hmm. But the point is this, we are in engaging in the extraction of our natural resources, whether it's forestry, gold, diamond, bauxite, or now petroleum. We are raising a lot of costs that we have to bear.
Yes.
Why is society not speaking of these things?
Right. Yep, we are bearing a lot of these costs, and you're right. I mean, I just wish to, for emphasis, say, yes, you are right. Regulators are usually being paid to regulate by the people they regulate.
That's correct.
Right? Except in oil in Guyana. And Chris, on the tax thing, I mean, you know, there are taxes, twofold taxes that companies like this get away with. One is income tax, and the other is import tax.
Mm-hmm.
Because usually they have this, what you call it, that the GRE gives.
The duty, yeah,
duty free concessions, right? Mm-hmm. Thank you. So a lot of these extractive companies coming into the country now, we have to watch. Because the contracts that they are going to be drawing up for these countries and for these entities might very well follow the Exxon thing, because there's precedence.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And they're going to give them concessions up front, give them cheap land, and give them the tax breaks at the back end. And at the end of the day, I can say this a million more times, it is us, the taxpayers of this country, that's paying the politicians to do this to us.
Not only paying the politicians, we are the ones who are paying Exxon taxes.
We are paying Exxon taxes.
And paying to regulate them, and they're not being regulated.
Correct. Yeah. I would like to take us back to the previous, I think it was the Jagmeo government, when Bai Shailing came into Guyana on the forestry conditions. Bai Shailing started in forestry, ended up in gold mining, and then lo and behold, they ended up into trucking
and housing and everything.
And everything else. Now the trucks that they got in duty free,
yes,
for timber, they were starting to use,
yes,
to truck, fetch stone and sand and whatever else, having brought in these trucks duty free to do forestry,
mm-hmm,
but they're now being used to do something else.
Well, you know, my view is the Chinese have more influence and power in Guyana. If you want a piece of land, you probably need to go to the Chinese and say, help me get a piece of land. That's the reality. That's the reality.
Right to the Chinese embassy.
Yes. It's very unfortunate.
Yeah.
Now, I think this is going to be a question that will provoke both of you. What do we do about the oil in the ground? You can't, it is not fair to ask Guyana to remain in poverty, deprived of the revenue that it can get from oil.
Mm-hmm.
Though we really ought to talk about the net revenue rather than the gross revenue.
Exactly.
Because the net revenue is the cost of all these oversight, etc. What should we do about the oil that we have discovered? Do we take the purest view and say, leave it in the ground? Do we say, drill, baby, drill? To use Sarah Palin's words? Or is there a middle ground that we should be looking for? Like maybe we did with the forest arrangement with Norway.
Yeah.
If you want us to leave the petroleum in the ground, pay us to do it.
Right.
I'm putting that question to you. I'm putting a second question to you. If everybody were to stop producing fossil fuel,
mm-hmm,
the world will be brought to a standstill.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yes. How do we deal with these arguments from opposite poles?
Well, Chris, let me take a first shot.
Yeah.
If you want to talk about, if we want to contemplate the purest view, as you call it, that, you know, leave the oil where it is, then where are you going to stop? What about gold? What about gold that uses mercury and leaves it in the ground? So I would think that...
Or forestry.
I would think that, you know what, you have natural resources that you must use for the betterment of your country and countrymen and exploit it. But in this day and age, after Exxon would have been in Guyana for so many years, why isn't our EPA, for example, the best in the world? So that we ought to be in a position where we can manage all the destructive elements that could come out of it, and politicians must not say when they're in opposition, we will have to relook at this contract, and when you get in power, say, well, sanctity of contract matters. No, what is best for Guyana is what matters. And I don't think our politicians see beyond the tit-for-tat, as you call it rightly in the press today, and see beyond the political game. What is good for Guyana, not what's good for a group of politicians.
Mm-hmm. My view, years ago I was a gold miner. I had gold operations in the bush. I extracted gold out of the jungle. I never did forestry, but I know people who did forestry. And I know Guyanese tend to cut the forests in very careful ways. We don't clear cut. We cut trees.
One here and...
That's right. Spaced out, let the young ones come back up, we grow it, stuff like that. That's how Guyanese do it. And we've been doing that for hundreds of years. And our forests have remained pristine because of that way of doing it. Where oil is concerned, as far as I'm concerned, leaving it in the ground is not an option. Because can anybody give us enough money equivalent to what, to the value of what the oil will bring to us? I doubt it. My view is, let us extract the oil.
Except, sorry to interrupt you. We don't know how much we're talking about.
We know how much oil we have.
No, but you say we don't know how much if they were to give us. Now, we've just heard COP26 talk about putting aside $100 billion a year. Clearly, Guyana would be one of the beneficiaries from that fund.
To what extent?
Well, that's what we have to work out.
Okay.
We did work out something with forestry with the Norwegians.
So
it's not beyond that.
Correct. Okay. But I am also saying that we can extract the oil in environmentally friendly and financially friendly ways to the benefit of Guyana. We need, as we come back to EPA, we come back to our Environmental Protection Agency, which we have now realized is a complete basic waste of time in Guyana because they're incapable of anything. They should have been creating...
I don't think as a country we should get rid of EPA.
No.
What we have to do is empower it.
Empower it. Yes. Strengthen it. Bring in technical expertise.
Yes.
Remove the politicians out of it. Take away the political control that controls the EPA. So we need to strengthen our EPA so we have strong EPA laws governing extraction of any natural resource, not only oil, but any. We must have insurance to cover any oil spill or any environmental damage done by the extraction of the oil. So to me, once we put things in place for protection, we go ahead and extract it and try to make sure that the companies that are extracting it work according to our guidelines, so that these disasters are, the percentage probability of it happening is minuscule.
You see, look, we've now been in oil production close to 2 years.
Yeah.
Good. We never did a baseline study. in terms of the ocean and fish at that stage. We don't know what the impact is. We don't have a depletion policy. Our policy is drill, baby, drill.
Yes.
Exxon, you want to do whatever you just do it. I will see that it's done. So you can't place all the responsibility on the EPA. The EPA does not grant licenses. It does not grant exploration licenses or production licenses.
But if
it does not enter into petroleum agreements.
But if the EPA says government should not do this unless these things are in place, then they can come outright and say, hey, we did not grant, we're not in favor of granting this license or whatever.
No. They don't grant what they do in relation to environmental impact.
Yes.
They carry an examination and say whether or not
it's viable or not.
It is harmful
or not
to the environment, because that's what the name is.
Yes.
But they don't grant a petroleum agreement. They don't grant a forestry agreement. They don't grant a production agreement. So it's really back down to the politicians. But in my view, you have to have a depletion policy. Look at the contradiction. We talk about contradictions. You hear, and to the government's credit, it says, we're coming out with a local content policy. And the vice president says, but we're bringing in foreign labor.
Yes.
I mean, surely somebody has to listen. The two can't really go. So what? Are they, because do they automatically become local?
No, they should not be. They should not be, correct.
Under our laws, they cannot be. But then you never know.
But those laws should be changed as well.
Well, they did intimate that the laws may have to go through some revisions to accommodate exactly what you're saying. So that might be coming.
Yeah.
But Chris, you mentioned a very important point there, because Guyanese, it's an indictment on all Guyanese that they are unable to rise to the level that will make them employable. So you have to import these skill sets that you might need. However, I'm sure many people would know this. The contract has a clause in it where Exxon gives $300,000 a year, I think it is, for education, right? From 2016 to now, when the date of the contract to now, that's over 1.6 million US. And the aim, the purpose of that education ought to have been to train people to take over from the expatriates so that they could get into the system with their new skills. And every year it's supposed to happen.
If we don't have a policy on exploitation of the petroleum resources, otherwise you would have had, and again I come back to this, the law does require local content.
Yes.
We have practiced local content. The OMI contract was a model of local content. But again, we come back to see, nobody needs, everything is just made, the decisions are always made without any regard to the law or the fact.
Yeah.
What, we talk about a depletion policy. What is a realistic goal? Now, Mr. Jagdeo is right. We do have probably 20 years of petroleum operations. And maybe we should try to get all that we want. But then what do? In trying to get that, you make the overtopping of the seawall all the more likely.
Yeah.
So there are consequences. How much will it cost? We do not want any studies. We don't want a study on the gas ashore. We don't want the Procurement Commission to be involved in anything. By the way, you guys know that there is no Procurement Commission.
Yes, yes, yes. In Article 13, actually, we have discussed that there are a number of areas that the government has been really, not forthcoming in ensuring that it maintains its constitutional mandate. In fact, you know, it reminded me when Donald Ramatow was president, Granger, then opposition leader, would have said that the president was sleepwalking into a constitutional nightmare. And then he did it himself, of course. And now here we have a number of agencies, Chris, and we are hoping we are going to come out with a statement soon on these things.
Well, maybe we can have a quick conversation.
Yes, sure.
On the question of the Chancellor and the Chief Justice. Mm-hmm. It's now almost, what? I think Desiree Bernard, Honorable Desiree Bernard.
I think she was confirmed.
Was the last confirmed person. Yes. I think she left in 2005.
Yeah.
Sometime around then.
So you're looking at 16 years.
You're looking at 16 years.
Carl Singh and Ian Chung.
Carl Singh retired while acting, right?
So was Ian Chung.
Ian Chung retired.
Both retired as acting. Mm-hmm. But they'd been in the position for numerous years mm-hmm. without being confirmed. So and then we have Janet Cummings and then we have Wilshaw.
Do you think these Roxanne acting... Wilshaw. Sorry, do you, I know you're the moderator. Do you think these acting positions are carrot and stick kind of approach by any government? I mean, APNU also kept people in acting positions.
Well, it's certainly, in my view, it's certainly hampers the independence of the judiciary. First of all, it should be taken away from the president and the leader of the opposition. It should be a judicial service commission.
But then you don't have a judicial service commission.
Yeah. I mean, this whole thing becomes farcical.
Which is appointed by the president. Well, the president and...
Yes.
Others. So...
So, you like me, you dabbled in the law. What's your view on this matter?
Well, I would say dabbled a little bit. You have been in it a lot.
I just dabbled.
But Chris, your letter in the press speaks to it. And I quoted it earlier with one part where, you know, the politicians basically, they operate on a tit-for-tat basis and not moving ahead with the agenda of our nation. But I believe that, look, would they have left the chairman of GCOM acting? They can't. You know, it's a different body. But in a similar way, how can you have these people operating, Chancellor of the Judiciary and all these people acting for years and years and years? The right phrase you've used, it signals a strong judiciary. The independence of the judiciary stands up and speaks to the world when people are appointed.
Yeah.
We are all unhappy with some decisions made at various stages in the law courts.
Well,
Look,
Lord Denning, one of the greatest, the Times described him as the greatest of the 20th century.
Yeah.
He has had numerous of his decisions overturned.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
And he's still regarded as the greatest jurist.
Correct.
So what's wrong? No, nobody can defend the majority of 65. That's really an egregious one.
Yes.
But judges make they rule based on the information and the submissions of the counsel.
But Chris, might sound childish, in the minds of the ordinary Guyanese, people will not be independent if they're acting.
That's correct.
And the last government was also guilty of the same thing.
Yeah.
They did not properly appoint these people.
Now,
go on,
Jonathan.
When your letter appeared in the papers, I went to the Constitution and I checked it out and I saw that all that is needed is an agreement between the president and the leader of the opposition. There's absolutely no need for a physical meeting, a virtual meeting, a meeting of any kind, just an agreement. So in my mind, the president needs to write a letter to the leader of the opposition. I would like to appoint Miss A to the position, Miss B to this position. I would like your thoughts on it, your agreement on it, not your thoughts, your agreement on it. It's now in the ballpark, the court of the opposition, leader of the opposition. He can write back and say, no, I don't agree, and these are my reasons why.
That's correct.
Correct.
Now,
but I would like to just encourage all viewers, you know, if you can, That letter is extremely important. It's I would say one of the hallmarks of you know good reasoning and good advice that comes to the government. That is your letter in today's today's.
Well, let me ask. Let's move. Let me ask this one. The government or governments have not only been tardy, and I would say derelict in addressing the issue of the appointment of the Chancellor of Jesus, but several critical constitutional bodies as well.
Yes.
So it is just a complete malaise that we don't give a damn about the Constitution.
Yeah.
We're in power. We have a one seat or a two one seat majority or something to that effect.
Yeah.
And we can do what we want.
Mm-hmm. One seat makes you a dictator.
Well, you know, and the way we have been throwing money around, and by the way, I don't know that any disclosure has been made as to the source of the monies. You spoke earlier of the flood relief and the COVID cash grant and so forth. And I just want to quickly mention something, Chris. Every Guyanese that has received those grants, mm-hmm. they're thankful for it. It's what governments should do.
Mm-hmm.
But governments should also be accountable. As yet, I am still to see, and I don't know if you gentlemen have seen it, but I'm still to see total disclosure
mm-hmm.
of the monies, how it was spent, how many people actually received, and stuff like that. And all you're hearing is all these talks. Security company get you know a fraction mm-hmm. of it to accompany people. But to come back to your point, the government has to move and move very, very quickly on the appointment of the Chancellor of the Judiciary and so forth. Because Chris, as you rightly said, the malaise is there. We have some globe-trotting politicians in Guyana. From the last government to this one, they have moved from China to now Glasgow. But and that's fine. They might have their political agenda, but the malaise is there because the work that the people of this country needs to get done is not getting done. And I want to just mention something that I've written to the media three times about Integrity Commission.
Yeah.
You know, one of those bodies. I mean, let's get these bodies properly appointed and let the people do their work.
Yeah.
Well,
without political interference.
Well, you mentioned Integrity Commission.
The Judicial Services Commission.
Judicial Services Commission.
There's a Procurement Commission.
Procurement Commission. Is there a Public Service Commission?
Public Service Commission.
Is there a Human Rights Commission?
Correct. Ethnic Relations.
Ethnic, I think, is functioning. I don't know if they're
reappointed or
reappointed or what. But I think they're still functioning.
What harm do you think, apart from the obvious fact that you're violating the Constitution, on mm-hmm. this is serious violation.
It is serious.
It's anti-democratic.
No. There's a more fundamental problem. Chris is right.
Yeah.
The Constitution foresaw a problem, conflict of interest, just one of them, in not having these independent commissions set up. And by you taking on the role of the commission, because if there is no commission, it means you, the government, are gonna do all the work.
So it's back to the minister.
Yeah. And so there's a total, you know, total lack of the lines that should be there to stop abuse of power.
This is why I say it's anti-democratic, because we came out of a five-month fight for democracy in Guyana.
You were actually fighting.
I was actually in the fight, yes.
I think Jonathan is mistaken, Mr. Ram. I think, yeah, nobody. There was only one or two persons that fought for democracy in Guyana. Sorry.
No, Guyana just came through a very tumultuous time for democracy. And now here we are with a new government. But all the anti-democratic systems and symptoms are there. Not renewing boards, not appointing commissions as they should. All these things are there as checks and balances against a government running Wild West. And we are not having these things done.
Well, let me give you another example. This farce, I'm sorry, I express my own views on this program.
Mm.
This farce of no objections.
Oh, yeah.
You're making a decision
yes.
as if you don't have an objection.
To it. Yeah.
Correct.
No objection has to do with if, for example, somebody else did something and you have some say in the matter.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah, every time I see that, I cringe.
Yeah. They're not objecting to their own decision.
Yeah.
How stupid is that?
Yeah.
If I made the decision, how can I object? But why would I object to it?
But Chris, we can't let these points go without mentioning the following two. And our group has been seriously contemplating what we can do. So there is a problem. What can we do about it?
Mm.
And I think the 5 months you mentioned, in which every man, woman, and child in this country started to stand up and speak out,
we
need to return to a similar kind of thinking where Guyana is ours. It doesn't belong to any political party, and Guyanese must start to stand up and speak out. We become quiet, we fall into the same malaise because we are probably a recipient here and there of whatever, contracts or employment or anything. But the rest of us, you know, we have to meet that stage where we can speak out.
Well, speaking out is one thing, but what about some action? What about legal action?
Yeah, I agree.
I'm not a lawyer, but I leave that to you. But what I will say is...
But you're the people who make us, who give us a living.
I need to be defended legally in court. But what I will say is, what happens is, in Guyana, tribalism. I'm not going to say racism, I'm going to say tribalism. This is my tribe, this is your tribe. My tribe wins the elections, my tribe, people from my tribe are elected into government. Whatever they do, my tribe shuts their mouth and accepts and says nothing. The opposing side, their people will start to object to whatever this tribe does because they are now in the opposition. Instead, and what is happening is neither tribe is working or trying to work together for the benefit of Guyana.
Well, in that case, it's one step forward, one step backward.
That's right.
And it's...
That's right.
Now, I think we have a slight problem. I don't see the light coming on. I'd rather stop the program about now.
Okay.
We did have...
We started a bit late.
But we've used back 40 minutes.
Okay.
Just some closing thoughts. Maybe about Article 13 and... which has been silent for a while.
Well, yes. I mean, we have been going through some planning. Being in Guyana and looking at our constitution and looking at the various things that we have in front, challenges, it's not easy. The challenges are a lot. Unfortunately, we also have a thing in Guyanese where everything is being, you know, belittled and made to look like, insignificant. So what we are looking at, Chris, for example, these constitutional bodies, areas that we feel are very important, we are going to raise it. We are planning some stakeholder forums ourselves. We are looking at joining with you and the legal fraternity as we look at the legal implications of some things that are happening. For example, constitutional reform. Constitutional reform is there, but what is happening with it? Over to you, sir.
Quickly.
We need to become very active. Under the previous government, the PPP had certain stakeholders who tried to start the civic Articles 13 with civic society. They are now silent. They are now absolutely silent. And we are now trying to take that mantle up to get consultation from this government to get things done.
Well, I wish you luck. I want to thank you very much. And,
thank you.
Again, I wish all Guyanese
Happy Diwali.
Happy Diwali and yoga. I love your shirt and the home sign on it.
Thank you.
So, operators and viewers, thank you very much. And good night. See you next week.
Okay.
I think we use an hour.
Yeah.
While I'm living, thanks I'll be giving the Most High. I'm a living while I'm living to the